Mistakes are unavoidable when it comes to learning anything new, and Ubereats is no exception. The best thing about mistakes, though, is you don't have to go through them yourself. You can learn from someone else who's already done them, so you don't have to personally experience them. That's why in this video, I'm going to be sharing with you 10 Ubereats mistakes I see drivers making, mistakes that I've made, and the remedies you can do to fix these. And in this industry, when you fix a mistake, that means your income goes up. So let's get into it. Hello everyone, this is Elijah with the RideShare Guy, and in this video, we're going to be talking about 10 mistakes that Ubereats drivers tend to make and what you can do to fix these. By fixing these mistakes, you'll find that your Ubereats driving experience will be smoother, and you'll find that your income will either go up or the time that it takes you to complete an order will go down, which by default tends to make your income go up. So the first mistake new drivers tend to make is they take an order to another address that's different from what's in the Uber app. The way this plays out is you go pick the order up, and then the customer contacts you asking you, hey, I put the wrong address, can you bring it here? Now, the reason this is a mistake is because it could cause you to drive a lot further than you should, which ends up eating into your money because, one, a lot of miles are not paid because Uber is only going to pay you for the distance that should be traveled based on the address in the app. Now, the solution to this is not to never, ever take an order to another address. It's just to be aware of this and actually think about the situation and does it make sense for you. A lot of new people feel like they're obligated to when you're not. Your contract and payment is based on that address that's already in the system. You don't have to take it to this new address. With that being said, there are a lot of scenarios where it actually isn't that big a deal, and I personally will still do it. If the new address is less than a mile away, I tend to still do it because, you know, it is what it is. But if it's more than a mile away, I start to think, well, do I feel like driving that distance? And if I don't, I tell Uber support to cancel it. Another option is to actually get compensated for driving the extra distance, but you do have to let support actually know ahead of time. So when you get this message, you need to ask the customer exactly where is the new address, and then you need to let support know that you're going to bring it to that new address and you need to be compensated for it. Keep in mind that there's a cap on that. I'll talk about this in more detail in the 3 Ubereats scams video that we've done, so you might want to check that video out after you finish watching this one. Mistake number 2 is going too fast. I know that might seem kind of contradictory to what you've heard or maybe even intuitively know, but if you go too fast, this could actually cost you money. I'm going to swing back to a time where I dropped off an order for a customer, and I was so fast that she actually was going to give me a tip, but I walked away too soon. But I heard her say that, but it was kind of awkward for her to say, hey, wait, I got a tip for you. So she didn't, and I lost out on money. So I've trained myself to wait 3 to 5 seconds before I actually walk off and just say, hey, thanks for ordering Uber Eats, all that good stuff. That's enough time so that they can slide in, hey, I have a tip for you, if they're going to give a cash tip. And even though we are in a pandemic and a lot of people are doing the contactless delivery, let's say if they're not doing that, you still want every opportunity that's possible to get a tip. So when you're dropping the food off, just slow down for a moment so you can position yourself potentially to get a cash tip. The third mistake is not using Waze as a navigation when you're driving for Uber Eats. That might seem a little biased, but hear me out. So in case you don't know, Waze is a navigation app that allows you to navigate throughout your city, just like Google Maps and even the Uber navigation. But what those other apps don't have is the ability to set little markers or hotspots, as I like to call them, inside the app. The way you do this is by opening the Waze app up, typing anything in search, and then the words favorites is going to pop up. You click on that, and you can just click on add favorite. So what relevance is that to you as an Uber Eats driver? Well, as you're going to find out later in this video, the Uber Eats algorithm works based on you being positioned in the right spot. And let's say when you find out what that spot is, you can just put that spot in the Waze app, and as soon as you finish your order, you just piggyback to the closest hotspot so you can position yourself to get another order as soon as possible. A lot of Uber Eats drivers are actually sleeping on this tactic, and while this is about Uber Eats mistakes, even a lot of intermediate drivers are sleeping on this tactic. So this is an advanced technique that you can use to tower over the competition. Mistake number 4, not being familiar with your city. Now, you may be familiar with it in terms of driving around, but you need to become familiar with it in terms of the restaurants on Uber Eats and the quality orders that they give you as a driver. What I do for my own city is I have my city divided like a quadrant: northeast, southeast, northwest, southwest. And in those quadrants, I kind of rate the quality of restaurants and quality of orders I get from those restaurants. After you've been doing Uber Eats for a while, you'll notice that some restaurants tend to give you short trips, some give you longer trips, and depending on which one of those type of orders that you want, you'll know what quadrant to head to in your city so that you can make the most money. Let's say you just had a long trip that took you about 6 miles away, but you know this particular part of the city, which isn't that far away, will actually give you a short trip. Now you can slide an extra trip in that hour if you head towards that quadrant, as opposed to sitting still, then you get another 6 or 7 mile delivery, or you start getting those type of deliveries. Well, you only made X amount of dollars in that hour when you could have slid an extra one in if you knew which parts of your city offered short trips. Of course, this isn't going to happen overnight, but as long as you're aware of what I said, it'll start gradually happening because you'll have an X-ray vision to actually see what trips the restaurants are giving you, and you'll be able to position yourself properly. Mistake number 5, taking stack trips from the wrong place. A stack trip is when you've accepted an order, then you're heading to the restaurant, and then another order pops up that you have an option to take. Taking that order means that you'll be carrying 2 deliveries, which means you'll be having 2 drop-offs. While this technically means that you'll be making more money because you're dropping 2 orders off, it may be more trouble than it's worth. First off, you only get 1 pickup fee instead of 2 pickup fees, so you're already not getting that. And the second thing is, the drop-off fee, as you can see on the screen, is kind of minute. That's not really worth it. So if that second order is in an area of town where you're going to encounter a lot of obstacles, let's say apartment complexes, apartment buildings, it's going to take a while for you to complete that second order. You can actually kill your per hour average on the spot. So you might want to consider actually just declining that stack trip because it may not overall be worth it. Mistake number 6, not taking stack trips in certain places. That might seem contradictory to number 5, but the reason I have this as number 6 is if you ignore all stack trips, you could be missing out on an extra $3 or $4 per hour. This ties back into an earlier mistake that we've talked about knowing your city. But let's say you're on the way to a restaurant to pick up a delivery and you get another stack trip. Now, as it stands, Uber Eats doesn't show the location of that second trip. Hopefully they'll fix that in the future. But if that restaurant tends to give you like these little short trips that are like between like 2-3 miles, maybe even less than a mile, well, guess what? Chances are that stack trip is going to produce a short trip. And if that's the case, once you drop off that order, your first order, you can go on and move on to the second order, which is usually close by, drop that off. And if both customers tip, hey, guess what? You're looking at an extra bonus for that hour. And it wouldn't have happened if you didn't take that stack trip. Now, I will say that your area has a lot to do with this, because if you're in the part of the city that has a bunch of apartment complexes and like skyscrapers, that stack trip may not actually be worth it. So keep in mind of what part of the city you're in. But let's say you're in a part of a city that has just a bunch of houses, rarely anything else. Well, houses are very fast delivery, so you might as well grab that extra $3 or $4 while you're at it. Mistake number 7, not using Uber Eats support. So a big appeal of the gig economy in general is the ability to just kind of work on your own. And don't get me wrong, that's fascinating. But there are moments where if you just contact support, things go smoother, and you may be leaving money on the table if you don't. A great example is if you arrive at a restaurant and it's closed for whatever reason, a lot of people will just cancel that delivery. When if you just contact support, there's actually money on the table because they'll compensate you a certain amount because you did drive to the restaurant. That's just an example of getting support involved, which led to you getting more money. So just take that into consideration when certain situations arise. Sometimes, if you feel like you should be compensated for something, chances are you actually can be. You just have to contact support and let them know the situation. Mistake number 8, sitting in front of a restaurant waiting for a ping. A lot of people have this misconception that, hey, if I sit in front of this restaurant, I'm going to get a ping from that restaurant. And that's not necessarily the case. See, the Uber Eats algorithm works in a certain way. You know, a sonar wave expands outward. Think of a reverse sonar wave. So that means it starts outward and starts coming back in. And that means that drivers that are further away from the restaurant are getting pinged first. What that means for you is that most people are going to get pings before you do, and someone's going to take it, and you're wondering why you're not getting any pings just sitting in front of a restaurant. That's because you're sitting in front of the restaurant. The sweet thing that you want to do ties back into mistake number 3 and the remedy for it, but you want to make your own hotspots that are in between a bunch of restaurants, usually like between half a mile or a mile, and you'll be the most likely to get the most pings
over other drivers. Because when the Uber Eats algorithm starts trying to pull drivers, the people who are far away on the end, they're going to reject it because that's too far away. And it's not going to get to people in front of the restaurant. But if you position yourself just right, you'll be getting all the pings in the area because you're in that right middle spot. So the remedy to this mistake is to pay attention to where you find yourself getting pings. And if you start getting the most pings in a certain area, that's the place you need to piggyback to once you finish a delivery so you can position yourself to get another delivery quickly.
Mistake number 9, not knowing where your money is coming from. Now there's a lot of ways that you can get paid as an Uber Eats driver, and newer drivers tend to lump all this in the sum of, oh, this is what I make with Uber Eats. That's a mistake. So the main 4 ways are you have what Uber Eats pays you, then you have tips from customers, then you have promotions that Uber Eats does. One of them is Boost, and the other one is Quest. And you need to look at your trips to see where your money is mainly coming from, because you can devise strategies based on where your money's coming from. I'll give you an example. So you find out that most of your money is coming from customer tips in this part of town. Oppose that to another part of town where Uber Eats always has a Boost zone wrapped around there. Well, Boosts operate based on how far you're driving in terms of distance. So the farther you go, the more money you'll be making from Boosts. So in that particular case, you'll want trips where the drop-off is a little farther away so the Boost can actually pay off. If it's a short trip, you're not really going to get much in terms of a Boost. Meanwhile, in the area where you're making most of your money in tips, you want those shorter trips because the more trips you get, the more chances for tips are coming your way. See how I just distinguished what I'm going to do based on where my money is coming from? And since we can see exactly where we're dropping off with Uber Eats now, this plays even more of a role because we know exactly how far something's going to go and also where it's going to go. So we want to take advantage of that information and parallel it with how we're making our money. And that requires that you look at your trips and just kind of break it down. Is the money coming from Quests, from Boosts, from tips, or what Uber is paying me? Usually it's not the fourth one, just being honest.
Number 10, not using saved messages in your phone. So if you've been delivering for Uber Eats, even for like a day or two, you're probably going to start to notice that some customers don't leave the details that you need to get to them. So they live in an apartment or an apartment building. They're not putting the gate code. They're not putting the codes you need to get in the front door. They're not putting all the information you need to get to them in a timely manner. So what happens is you end up having to call them or text them, and that takes even longer than it needs to be. The way you can remedy this, and the way I remedy this, is to save these standard text messages in my phone. And the moment I see they're in an apartment complex, I send this message asking for that information. For instance, as soon as I get the food and I'm on the way to the customer before I actually start driving, I zoom in to see exactly where they are. And the Uber Eats app can tell you if it's in an apartment or not. It'll say, like, you can tell just by looking on the outskirts, hey, that's an apartment. So with that being the case, I always ask for the apartment number, the apartment name, and also the gate code. Now, keep in mind that they may have given some of that stuff in the app, but if I don't see all three, I still send that standard text message so they can get that information to me. Most of the time, they text that information to me before I actually get to the spot, which means I now have all the information I need to make the delivery in a timely manner. You got to remember, it's to their benefit too. They're hungry. They didn't put all the information. Maybe they forgot or whatever. And here you are asking for it, of course they're going to send it to you.
And there we have it. We have 10 mistakes that are costing Uber Eats drivers like you money, but that's not going to be the case now, right? With that being said, it's time to close out. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up for YouTube algorithm. Helps us out a lot. As well as subscribe if you're new and hit notifications so you can be notified when we drop a new video. We drop new videos every single week. And if you have any questions, you can also shoot us an email. Be safe and profitable, everyone. I will catch you in the next video.